I'm Margaret Miller, director of the Contemporary Art Museum and Graphic Studio. I'm so thrilled to see so many people here tonight. And it's my pleasure to welcome you and to introduce you in a moment to our artist who will be talking with Christian Viveros-Fauné tonight, Lisa Yuskavage. We've been having a lot of fun. She's seen the exhibitions, which I hope you all have, over at the Contemporary Art Museum. There are two related exhibitions, as you know, Jess Murry Rising and Necessary Angels, that have both Jess Murry and Lisa Yuskavage as part of the exhibition. Jarrett Ernst worked on the Jesse Murry exhibition, and then Christian and Lisa and Jarrett worked on the second exhibition, and we're really thrilled with the way they turned out, and I hope you'll all see the two shows. They close on December 3rd, so you have a while to see them. I just want to acknowledge that we have a few great guests here. Rebecca Nagy is here. She's the former director of the Harn Museum at the University of Florida. I think you've moved into this area now, is that right? And you live here now. And Christian Viveros-Fauné has been working with us since 2018 as our curator at large. And he is going to introduce Lisa and be part of the conversation with her in just a moment. I just want to say shows like this take a lot of work from staff, and I'm not going to name all the staff, but I really am very, very grateful to the Contemporary Art Museum staff, to the College of the Arts, to the events staff for putting this together. The reason we're in here is because the concert hall has had some disaster with their sprinkler system. And so you can't go in there, and so we moved over here, but I think it will work out quite well. All right, we were supported for this exhibition by several grants, and most particularly Stanton Store's Embrace the Arts Foundation came through and helped us. And we're very grateful for the support we get in our community and through grants. And so that's about all I have to say. And I'm now going to introduce Christian Viveros-Fauné, who will introduce you to our guest artist tonight, Lisa Yuskavage.
Rhymes with savage. Anyway,
Are you warming me up to be in a good mood?
It should be a good mood. It's good. We're going to talk about rage and anger and the way that can get channeled into beautiful things.
Okay.
There you go. I can't tell you how excited I am to be here tonight with Lisa. Lisa is a longtime friend. From whom I've learned, frankly, a lot. Among other things I've learned from her is that I'm not particularly good at making friendships unless I genuinely admire people for one reason or another. With Lisa, then, it has been particularly easy for me to continue to maintain my interest in having a tight friendship with her. I trust all of you know Lisa's work in some fashion. Some of you might know her for combining, among other elements, the female form and saturated color, high and low references, the sacred and the profane, others for her use of color and Renaissance technique, others for the way her paintings bait or sometimes fulfill or frustrate psychologically driven theories of viewing, such as the gaze, which we've heard about plenty in relation to painting in general since the early 90s, the mid 90s, but specifically in terms of Lisa's work. Her work, I think, as we'll see in the slideshow that she prepared for us today, is about this and so much more. It's gone from strength to strength over a career that spans more than 30 years. In doing that, her work continues to succeed exactly to the degree that it refuses to be pinned down to any one of its many conflicted meanings. I only load the gun, she once told me and has told any number of other sort of interlocutors. To those who insist on viewing painting as an explanation. The implication is, of course, that the rest is up to you, right? I once called Lisa America's greatest badass painter in print when I was working for ArtNet. I've since amended that view. I actually think that on the evidence of several decades of work, both in galleries and museums, there's a pretty good case to be made that she's America's greatest living painter. For those that don't agree with me, we can take it outside and, you know, pelt each other with coffee and sweets. In any event, this conversation, or this talk really, but we'll be sharing sort of, we'll be going back and forth of the slides, is about Lisa talking mainly about the development of her work, but there is also obviously an important tie-in to the reason she's here in the first place, and that is to celebrate her friendship with artist and writer Jesse Murry, a polymathic talent who is clearly sort of on view over in the galleries, not but a hop, skip, and a jump over, right, who died tragically of AIDS in 1993. Jesse and Lisa, for those who have not yet seen the show, met at Yale in 1984 when interviewing for the school's MFA program, ergo this photo, right? Murry was black, gay, worldly, originally from the South, and 14 years older. A real bona fide intellectual, a solid sort of like intellect. I think you've described him as the smartest person you've ever met. Yuskavage was talented, if somewhat, she was 22 years old and talented, if somewhat frustrated by like having landed at Yale, because it, I imagine, could be a place where class might impinge on one's sense of self, right? Who wouldn't be? Long story short, they got on like a house on fire and changed each other's lives and works for the better. The bonds of their creative friendship, again, are on view over at the galleries in both Jesse Murry Rising and in Necessary Angels, Jesse Murry and Lisa Yuskavage. Those are the shows that we have. If you haven't seen them, hurry the F over, get over there and go see them, particularly you students, because I think, among other things, they have a number of sort of lessons for you to learn, which aren't just about art and art making, they're about sort of friendships and creating scenes, even if a scene is sort of between two people and that's the way it sort of radiates out. Those are fundamental lessons for actually being in school, and then for living after you get out of school, right? Anyway, before I take up any more airtime, because we've got some slides to go through, because Lisa is nothing if not a generous speaker and a generous person, let me just, well, actually, first let me introduce Lisa. Lisa, thank you so much for being here. We're tremendously sort of glad and happy to have you. It's a particular charm for me, as I just said. But let me actually first sort of like lay the, you know,
you're not going to say my resume, are you?
No, just the two, that was your resume.
Okay.
Just the like two or three ground rules. We're going to go through slides, right? Lisa's basically going to talk mostly, and I'm going to prompt every now and again, right? And we're going to stop sharp at 7:45 for questions and comments, and then we're going to move forward, and at 8, we shut it down, right? Okay? Oh, yes, and then that's followed by coffee and sweets and fighting if anyone wants to take me on. Oh, right, yeah.
And you get a free catalog.
You get a free catalog.
And if you have a Sharpie, I'll sign it for you.
There you go. That's an offer.
And
I told you she was generous.
So, the sweet thing about this photograph is it was taken by my mom, who's here in the front row. In May 1986, Murry Yuskavage, who lives not far from here, and was, you know, there for the day that I met Jesse Murry in the basement of the Yale Art and Architecture Building, where Jesse was laughing at me because I was yelling at my parents to leave me the fuck alone, like a brat,
because I was, you know, a child being helped by my generous parents, and I was, and he was obviously laughing at me for being such an asshole, and I was like, I hate that guy, and I hope he doesn't get in. And then cut to, and if you haven't read the things that were written about Jesse and I over and over again, the anecdote where Jesse apparently, which I found out later and have talked about, Jesse apparently sashayed into his interview, which we were both interviewed by Andrew Forge, who was really a great, great art historian who unfortunately died of cancer, and a wonderful guy. And he aced his interview by saying, doing a Bette Davis interview, I didn't come to New Haven to tear the ivy off the walls of Yale. So anyway, he was an amazing erudite, but also one of the things I like to point out about Jesse is that he had a massive command of popular culture as well as high culture, philosophy, you name it. He could do voices, he could do everything. So that when, you know, years later, the night that he died, and for the years afterwards, all I kept walking around saying was, where did it all go? The void of so much. He was so much. I don't know if you know people that you feel like you'd like to avoid because they're called too much. Like you kind of like don't like them because they're too much. He was one of those people. I'm one of those people. We were kind of together. People used to say, oh, they're kind of too much. So we were kind of too much together in school. And people who are too much are kind of amazing. And I sort of, he's too much, actually. you know, over the years, you learn to temper it a bit. But it's like Jesse had voracious appetites for everything, including food. And I missed him so much. But what really drove me crazy was, like, really, more than anyone who had ever known who died, it was just like I just kept sort of feeling like, where does all of that data go? Like what he was, what he did. And it was like, I just felt like a guppy, like a couple of times I fished, you know, and like kind of like you would watch a fish kind of gasping for like how do I kind of get this to come back? Like how do I get this to come back? And I would talk to anybody and everybody I could talk to about Jesse Murry, Jesse Murry, Jesse Murry, and it would just fall to the floor. Nothing ever happened. And at some point, Art in America asked me to do something, like as my own career grew, someone asked me to write something about someone who inspired me or something, and I said, well, I know.
Pretty section called Muse, right?
Muse, the Muse section, and I said, I would like to write about Jesse Murry, and so I did, and again, nothing, just like big fat zero, nothing. But the weird thing is, what seems like silence, there were things being planted, and certain crops take time. Ooh, Jesse. He loved a stormy sky. When I was swimming last night, I was swimming in this pool, and the sky was doing this thing, and I was like, hello, Jesse. Anyway, but it was like this. So cut to, like, during COVID, the David Zwirner Gallery, there were a couple of the directors asked if I would curate a show of Jesse in this group of shows they were doing to kind of honor, why don't we move to another image. This is Jesse at Yale, very proudly standing in front of one of his works. And
looking very svelte, by the way.
With his funny, he was like, he would love to, like, his hair, he never combed, which was always very funny. He was just always like in his studio, just disheveled, like in this great way. I loved just looking at these pictures, just is amazing. But anyway, so they came to me and asked if I would curate a show of him, and I was like, I'm not a curator. Like, forget it. And then I was like, wait a minute, this is what you've been waiting for. So I drew in Jared Ernest, and who had been interviewing me about me, but was really curious about Jesse. And Jared is very much a Jesse-like character.
Another too much.
Be another too much person, for sure. Minus the blackness and minus the being dead, you know. And so he was also being from the South.
Yeah, from Arcadia, right around
here,
actually.
Yeah, and so this kind of understanding immediately of Jesse's thing. So I had a box of Jesse's writing that I'd carried around with me for 30 years, and I handed it to him. And the book that I'm sure those of you who are studying with Jarrett, you've gotten the book of Jesse's writing. And that's what got turned into it. And so my friend Christian here sort of took this on. And I am so incredibly amazed at this show rising is Jesse moving beyond the quiet of the grave for those 30 years. So, you know, you don't forget people. And if you really, it was like, I just was like, whoa, it really happened. So at any rate, the next thing I'm going to show, and for those of you who may not go to the website, there is a much longer piece. One of the things that was important to me about the Rising show at Zwirner, and this is the second stop, and there'll be a third stop.
In Portland, Oregon, in late August of 2023, in the biennial.
So there's so little of Jesse in so take pictures of each other a lot and take videos. Mm-hmm. We all do that now with iPhones. There's very little of Jesse recorded. So one of the things that became important to me was, because Jesse talked a lot, to find any, I loved his voice so much, I became obsessed with finding any recordings of his voice. And it was during COVID, like really like 2020 COVID. And I got, it wasn't easy. And I won't even get into how hard it was to get this, but this is a recording that I found at the Archives of American Art. I mean, I really had to beat people up. Jesse, there's a thing called Jesseisms that all my friends know about, which one of the Jesseisms was Jesse used to go cut, slash, stab. And so that's what I did to get this. I just was like, no, you're going to give this to me. How do we play this now? So this is a teeny little excerpt of the recording that was, I didn't even know he did this until I insisted we find what might be of his. Let me set it up for a sec.
Yep.
So I found out, which is like all these years, I didn't know this existed. I was just hoping it existed, something existed. Turns out Jesse, being 14 years older than me, had been an art critic in New York City and was organizing panel discussions in Soho. This is him looking snappy in Soho, on Broome Street in 1970-something. And he was organizing panel discussions as a young art historian. He wasn't really painting yet. He only started painting. You have to understand, this was a man who was an art historian. He taught art history. He was organizing panel discussions. And when I met him, like, I was this like kid painting. I'd been painting longer than he had. And he came to school to start painting. And imagine, right? Like, so he was like way advanced intellectually, and was, so this panel discussion blew me away when I heard his voice. So this is a little excerpt. So what he did is he put together a panel discussion about expressionism, but he was so brilliant to put Anna Mendieta on the panel discussion, who is a performance artist. And as you know, she died very tragically. And there's something so moving here about him and Anna having a conversation about death. And I hate to be a Debbie Downer, but this is a really intense moment. But you can listen to this on the website more.
Yeah, the full thing's on the website.
The full thing's on the website.
Yeah.
My work really comes from a need of placing myself on the earth.
And that's Anna.
And, you know, placing myself, literally placing myself within the natural environment.
Is that really a death wish? Because the way I see it is, in your work, the body extends to nature, and nature extends to the body and the actual pieces. The way they leave a stamp, they leave the individual physical stamp of your body in that space, but they're not an imposition of a structure in that space. It's like an image that becomes a part of the space. So it seems to me that that is a both a life-affirmative kind of thing, because it becomes a part of the actual space in that kind of reciprocal relationship. A body extends to nature, and nature extends back through it.
Right, but I what you're saying is right, but I don't see, I mean, I think that that is, I don't see the death wish as a negative thing at all. I mean, because life is death, and death is life. And when that, I mean, like, it's a cycle. So therefore, you know, I personally feel that that's what it is. Now, you know, maybe you feel uncomfortable to spell out the fact that we all, whether we want to deal with it or not, have the death wish in us. We have the pleasure wish, and we have the death wish, the life and death. I mean, that's basically who we are and what we're doing here.
Anyway. That's a pretty intense piece, and that it's a little hard to hear. We cleaned it up a lot. It was really a bad recording, but it was so, and so just the title of the show, Jesse and Murry Rising, comes from the painting on the right, and so Jarrett and I, when we conceived of the show, because I knew Jesse, and Jarrett is so smart, whenever he would hear me say something and he would agree with me, I knew we were on the right track. I said, let's not put any words in Jesse's mouth. Let's just find what he already said. So when we saw the word rising on the title of that painting, the idea of bringing him back, that he's coming back, it's just a thrill, because this is Jesse and Murry Rising. And so that painting was one of the last paintings he made, and he considered it such a fine example and sold it to a dear, dear friend of his. And she really doesn't want to lend it, and we keep prying it out of her hands. And she knows
it was not easy. Yes.
She knows how important it is. Yes. But the important part of this pair, and next to the clip that I just played you, is the painting to the left is Abyss. So rising and abyss, and what Anna says, you know, there's the death wish, you know, and you know, it's like there's life, you know, it's what the cycle, whether you like it or not, that's what we're here for. And it's, I think it's pretty, you know, these two were having this intense conversation, and then like we just pulled it out of the National Archives, and I was like, God damn.
No, the rest of that group who was in that, I mean, like Nancy Spira was there, Philip Wofford was there. I mean, it was an amazing sort of panel that he set up.
He was doing that kind of work, and I didn't even know it. And I told Christian this in a text message, and we were both kind of weepy. I was, when he had installed the show, I said, you know, my biggest regret is that I was so young when he died. I was only 30. That I was too young to even appreciate how brilliant he was. You know, I'm 60 now, and I think I get it now, but I feel sort of bad that I think I used to annoy the shit out of him. And he was so patient with me. You know, like, sometimes I feel annoyed by younger friends, but I keep it to myself. I mean, he never really kept it to himself when he was annoyed with me, because often he was in pain, and struggling with his AIDS was no joke. So, you know, it was also kind of a combination of things. Anyway, so we're here to talk about also how Jesse and I influenced each other, and mostly how he influenced me, because we can't really talk to him about what I did for him. But so these paintings, Bad Babies, in 1990, I started making these Bad Baby paintings. It was a rather big break for me, because prior to this, I can't even get into what kind of paintings I was making. They didn't look like this. And it was a pretty radical shift. Most people came to my studio and were like, what the fuck are you doing? And Jesse came to my studio. He was quite unwell. They were very controversial even before they left my studio. A lot of people came to my studio and said, you're in the 19, what people don't realize today, because there's so much figurative painting, is that people weren't making figurative paintings at the time.
Correct.
I guess I just didn't know any better. And this is the kind of thing that I wanted to do. And I was also willing to fail. And I was having a great time doing it. These paintings gave me a lot of, I enjoyed these paintings. I'm gonna look at a few of them. And I had Jesse to my studio. These paintings are, I'll go like this, rather than give you sizes.
They're 34 and 1/8 by 30 inches.
Okay. But they're really, really saturated. But Jesse came to my studio and he said, who should land this punch?
I think it should be you.
I think maybe for safety we shouldn't say it.
Well, we can wait and say it when we actually see the painting that you made.
Well,
same title.
Jesse said when he saw these paintings, honey,
mama,
honey, you have to have your pussy screwed on straight to make these paintings. And I've been unpacking that comment for a really long time. So just for shits and giggles, I will run ahead and show you the painting that years later, because when you're, how do you run ahead on that?
How about just the arrow?
So I made a painting years later. Oh, you're so much better at that than me.
Yeah, two fingers.
It's the old two finger. Right, there it is. Two fingers. There we go.
Don't you know?
So years later, when you're grieving someone, there's also a fun way to grieve. Sounds so weird. I was in my studio and I was making this painting and I just made me laugh to think, and I called this painting Screwing Her Pussy on Straight. And there's a lot of references and there's a lot of images that I pulled through this lecture to show, and I was showing Christian how over the years I have honored Jesse in my work in ways that are just private to me, but I'm going to share them with you tonight, and just like ways in which he comes in and out of my work. After he died, his partner, George, and I packed up his studio. It was unpacked last year. It was in a storage locker in New York City in the same cardboard collars that we put them in. And it was kind of mind-blowing to unpack them. And I was like, and his studio was like right on the corner from my studio in the East Village. And one of the canvases Jesse really wanted to work on was this one. And it is 72-inch square. And it was a blank canvas, and he never got to work on it. And he had this plan to do a series of paintings of circles and squares. And George gifted me the canvas, and we carried it from East 4th Street down Avenue B to East 2nd Street into my studio. And I made this painting, and it's kind of based on a photograph of my mom. She was not nude in the photograph, but her and her friend used to fake smoke cigarettes. And so I took that photograph and made this painting. And I made a series of paintings later. I went ahead and bought this large canvas after that and made three paintings. I took the third one out for sake of time of blondes smoking. But I went ahead and did circles and squares in watercolors, thinking about Jesse. This was my way of soothing myself and loving him and sort of kind of being with him. So that's how work sometimes gets made. Anyway, I just wanted to think, he kind of was gearing up to that in these things, I think, but he didn't get there. And
I love the title of this, this one here. Yeah, that's the one being
Rider's
shown.
Rider's Eye?
In Rider's Eye. It almost makes me think that he was actually thinking about poking Rider in the eye. You know, all that gothic romantic stuff that was so sort of near and at the same time far from what he was trying to do.
So I don't think that there's a lot of, I don't think there's any Jesse in this, although I think he would have gotten a kick out of it, but this is one of Christian's favorite paintings I've ever made, and it's called Chrissy, and I often call Christian Chrissy La Creme because of this, but these are some of Christian's favorite paintings of mine, so we put them in.
It's on a cover of a collected essays that I did in whatever.
When I was looking at the slide talk, I was kind of looking at these paintings, and then looking back at like the Bad Baby paintings, and thinking about how much they kind of are similar in their tonality of confrontation and just being kind of funny and pissed off at the same time, which I kind of think, you know, there's kind of like these threads of times when these kind of images kind of come through in the work that kind of have that.
Can I mention the text exchange we had a couple of days ago where you were telling me about the Billie Jean King Vogue article where she was talking about Serena Williams retiring?
Sure.
Right? And about her evolving. I've got it written down here. So Billie Jean King wrote this article for Vogue, and in it she basically cited Williams saying, "I built a career on channeling anger and negativity and turning it into something good." Right? And then you wrote in the same text message, "She's absolutely right. It's good for people to be angry as long as it's about something important, but use your anger. Turn it into something positive."
Well,
silence.
I've talked about it, harnessing.
Yeah.
Well, I'm just looking at the time here. It's 7:33, and we're going to open this up to questions in 15 minutes
15
or
minutes.
Less. So I'm going to skip ahead. Speaking of anger.
Yeah, there you go.
I'm going to go to this painting that's hanging at the Metropolitan Museum. So if you ever get to the Met, get to the Met before they take this thing down. It's been there for a long time so far.
Part of the permanent collection. I mean, we should
It's part of the permanent exactly. collection, but it's not going to be permanently hung. Although, I don't know.
It might be, huh?
Maybe it is. Who knew? Who knows? There was a series of paintings that I made, like this one's in the show, like this one, Ditch, that's a pretty mean painting.
It's very Goya.
When I made this painting, I remember I had a neighbor walked into my studio, which, you know, it was out in Long Island, which I didn't have, any guard at the door. She just wandered in. Very nice lady. She's an oyster farmer. And she said, "Now, why would you want to make that painting?" And I was like, "I don't have an answer for you." But...
Were you asking me bizarre questions?
But I was like, But the real conversation is, it was a conversation between Jesse and I, long, long time ago, about the Tempest. I wasn't going to have that conversation with the oyster farmer.
No.
I just said, "Oh, Ruth, get the fuck out of my studio." No. No, but you're a nice lady, but you don't know anything about what I'm doing here. But no, it was just, I lock my door now.
That's a good idea.
But the point is, no, it is funny to think of somebody just wandering in. And I have had... repairmen come in and they were like, they're kind of like, "No, why are you doing that?" And, you know, various things like that. But this painting is an homage in some ways to The Tempest, because in The Tempest, if you don't know The Tempest, you know.
Get reading.
Go look it up. I'm sorry I'm not giving you the art historical example, but you go look it up soon. Giorgione's The Tempest, it was one of Jesse's favorite paintings. it was one of my favorite paintings. And the weird thing about being at Yale is the two poorest kids at Yale had both been to Europe, Jesse and I, and had actually seen these things in person. And also my husband, who was a Russian Jewish immigrant, and he had also seen it. So we had like this little weird powwow about this painting. And a lot of the American kids, you know, who had been from, you know, various other backgrounds, just, I think because modernism had taught people not to look at ye olde art. And I was like, you know, well, why wouldn't I want to look at old art? You know, I can handle it and still look ahead, and it's information. But anyway, in the Tempest, there's a guard and a storm and a mother suckling a baby.
Lightning and storm, as a matter of fact, for us Tempites.
It's a tempest.
Yeah.
Like something we have going on here every single evening. So anyway, this painting was this weird. I had a Ivory Snow ad that I had pulled out of a out of a magazine, and in a weird way, I looked at it and I said, "Oh, it's like the Tempest, but like kind of a weird idea that like the Ivory Snow, like there was like a much smaller Ivory Snow guy." And I thought, "What would I?" And then I love. It was another homage in a weird way from Jesse coming back through me. We used to read Wallace Stevens together. It was one of his favorite poets. And I didn't know nothing about no Wallace Stevens when I met him. And so he made me go, he said, "I'll sit here and wait until you go buy that book and come back." And I was like, that's very aggressive. He's like, "I can wait." Yeah. And I had to actually go, he was like that. "I'll wait." I had to go to the store and come back with it. And I still have my book that I had that day that I went and got, and it's like marked up. And, you know, what a life-changing thing. And he, one of the poems called The Snowman, which is really one of Stevens' great masterpieces, has also affected so many people like Jasper Johns. In Jasper Johns' show, The Gray Show at the Met, actually, that's so much a part of those gray paintings. Anyway, there's just so many times when I look through my work and I find pieces of memories of how Jesse and I talked about art and thought about things. And it's not just Jesse. I mean, I can probably find a lot of other friends and artists in here, but we're here to talk about that. At any rate, one of the things that Christian loves about this painting and what I did in this painting, and for students, I kind of ripped off pretty hardcore Goya, which is not a usual thing I would do, but I was so freaked out by that woman beating the shit out of a corpse with, and I was like, looking at that image, I have this big Goya book, and I was looking at that image of that peasant and with those thick arms and that hefty bosom, and she is so mad. And I was like, how angry do you have to be beating a corpse that's already got no head, no arms, and no feet? And I'm like, how angry do you have to be? And that really haunted me. And so for some reason, I just like was kind of like so into that woman. And she just became like a symbol of just rage.
It's actually like, you know, this is from The Disasters of War. It's plate 28. But these aren't titled. They're captioned, right? And the caption on this says populace, which means rabble or mob, which might have some connection to her present, right?
Mm-hmm.
But yeah.
And you know. And the when COVID happened and we had so much rabble, and I... You know, it's like there's always these times when you're like, you know, like. But the other thing is, like, I took the dead body out because, and I'd had a lot of dreams around that time about fires burning at night in the woods and walking in the woods with and fires burning, but also long waiting lines, I guess, for vaccines. I don't know. and there's a weird person with a mask standing behind her. And this painting was made and started in 2013. So there are times when, you know, as an artist, you just don't know where you're getting your information from. I'm going to skip ahead.
But in saying that, we're back to Stevens' sort of metaphysical argument about the imagination being just as strong as, like, the real, the emergency, right?
So going into COVID, I made this painting, which I was like, oh, shit. I remember those, like, crazy people on their lawns with guns, and I was like, I don't think I can show this painting. I was like this is not, I think I'm going to put this one in the vault.
I'm so glad you didn't.
It's called Scissor Sisters, which doesn't help my reputation as not a lesbian.
But. It was just, can you just say it's a band?
Anyway, just to show you that, like, so I made this painting Beach Fire well before I made the painting of the other thing.
Over at the museum.
And my last show was all about studios and shit going on in studios and nonsense and being an art student. And I put that painting of the Beach Fire in there. It's a demonstration. So it's like this painting is called Masterclass. Who's the master and who's the student? I put this page from a Wallace Stevens poem, The Final Soliloquy of Interior Paramour. This is from the book that Jesse made me go get and mark up and probably stood over me and made me write those marks. He was very demanding about that. But it's like the line in here, where... the second page. It's the knowledge which arranged the rendezvous. That's an amazing line in that poem. So this painting, Pink Studio Rendezvous, has been hanging at MoMA in relation to the Red Studio show.
The Matisse Red Studio show, which is up now.
And they may have just taken it down. They left it up long enough for my mom to see it, which was, I mean, they had a heart. Isn't that amazing? And look at this. Look at this son of a bitch.
I don't know who those people are. I have not a clue.
And before we wrap, the real hero of all of this is this man. This is Jesse's partner, George. Now, in the show, we have that video rolling that I made, that document, because there is a little piece of film, teeny little piece of film of Jesse talking about Howard Finster's work, because he was also a curator, and he curated a show of Reverend Howard Finster's work.
At the New Museum.
At the New Museum. And I remember when that documentary was made, he was so proud of himself, and he was like, talking to me about this, and I remember I was living on Ludlow Street, and I remember watching it with him, and I remember specifically the way he gesticulated and everything, and then when I got the opportunity to curate the show, I said, we're going to get that footage, and then, of course, I wrote, and they said, nope. That typical shit during COVID. Nope, it's COVID. And I was just like, cut slash stab, okay? You don't know who you're messing with here. Okay, so, of course, we got it. And Jarrett was like, they don't know who they're messing with. Jarrett bought me a cap that says cut slash stab. But anyway, this is the real hero of the show. This is Jesse's partner. And so the way I made that, the voices, has everybody or most of you seen it? So the voices, so just to wrap this up, because we're pretty good on time here, just to wrap it up. When Jesse was at the end, he was writing a poem, and because I said he never stopped talking. He talked. And I didn't even know this, and Jarrett actually found this out from George, because Jarrett actually drove down to North Carolina to visit George. And there's a lot that I didn't know, because when Jesse died, after packing the work, we all went our own way. Jarrett went down and really spent time with George going over these kind of handwritten poems and trying to actually understand what was written for the book. Jarrett is, if nothing, dedicated and thorough. I mean, seriously, it was like unbelievable what he did. So the way that I did this, and so what I found out is that I didn't know about this poem, and the poem, the aphorisms, were Jesse was intubated, so the first time that he couldn't speak, and he, in a shaking hand, wrote page, you know, it was like very large, handed it to George, and George read it back to him. And they were alone, and it was just put away, and George had that with him. I never knew about it. Jarrett told me about it. And when I was trying to figure out how to make something, how to show that film of Jesse gesticulating and talking, it's like less than 10 seconds. I'm like, I gotta build something out around that. What do I build out around that? I said, well, maybe I can do something with the aphorisms. And I thought, you know, he was alone in the end, but what if we come together and read it back to him? Because, you know, we're kind of an incantation. So I found all his friends, most of whom I didn't even know. And it was all like people who had been friends with him all through his life, his best friend from his childhood. And, you know, a lot of these people had to be really convinced that I was not up to no good. And that, you know, I wasn't being paid for this. And it was, you know, it was like, oh, I'm sorry, I'm touching my mic. That I was like making this, like, it was like an interesting process. So the way we did it, it was, you know, David Zwirner, like, very generously funded this. We did it all through Zoom, and people, like, George was in North Carolina. One of the speakers was in Sicily. There were people all over the place. And everybody had, like, technological issues and everything. But George is in his home, his very humble home. George has never taken a dollar. Just he's kept the work all these years and protected it. Now, I was just saying, Jesse, Jesse, Jesse. But I was not doing anything but just saying his name and saying, why doesn't anybody care? So last summer when I called George and I said I had his same phone number, and he picked up the phone. We came together to make this all happen, but it was like George is the real hero because he was the keeper of the work. And I just wanted you to hear how beautiful a person he is. And there's a moment here, and I took the clip where what I told everyone to do is to talk to Jesse, because none of them are actors, right? So I said, talk to Jesse. None of this was supposed to be taped. None of them really know. I didn't even get permission from them to do this, so that they don't even know that I have this. But there's a moment here where you can see that he's really talking to Jesse, because when he says the poet, there's a moment of such sweet love. Anyway, I just wanted to share it. It's only a minute. Then you guys can ask me questions about whatever you want.
He does not doubt the gift of naming. He, like God, names the merciful darkness with its new and other insights into horror of the unthinkable, of the unknowable, of the unsayable. The poet? O merciful darkness, by what tenderness embrace chaos? Kiss or caress the abyss, hallowed the void, hallowed be the void. Die without desolation, because the golden night persists even as it fades. It pervades the darkness. It advances from light into darkness. New paradox. Existence is a paradox. Yes, it is gorgeous forgetfulness that does not move. Cannot be moved. You cannot move the disaster or forget. It is eternal and imminent death, therefore immovable. You cannot forget death. We all die, not death.
I just ended it there. Anyway, that's George and his beautiful reading of the poem. That's what I got for you. Oh.
Last image on the slideshow.
That's Jesse and I at my wedding.
All right, we've got 10, maybe 12 minutes if we squeeze a couple extra minutes out of this for any questions, any comments. Yes, wonderful. We got plenty of them. You, please. Yes.
Loud.
As someone who kind of works in a very, like really meticulous way for a lot of works, they try to focus on narrative. The show really spoke to me in kind of the way Jesse described as like very intellectual and well-read and well-spoken, but still choosing to kind of go to abstract painting to kind of express larger ideas and more complex facets of the human experience. And so I just kind of was wondering if you had any insight or advice as to somebody who does want to like move towards abstract painting or more abstract work, but doesn't really know kind of how to get into that perspective.
I think you have to really educate yourself broadly. I think it's not focusing on painting that it sounds like you need to worry about. I think it sounds like you need to educate yourself on read, go see, you know, travel, see art. He wasn't rich and he somehow managed. You know, a lot of people will say they can't because they don't have any money. But it's just like, you know, you just got to be a pain in the ass, like he was, and get it. You know, don't stop, you know, make yourself a nuisance and apply for grants until people give you what you need. And, you know, read. He was, you know, he was self-taught. And, you know, like, I honestly think it's like, I don't know if this is really the answer to the question you want, but I mean, I think you have to become, you have to devour as much information as possible, and it will lay itself, it will organize itself for you. Most people don't know enough. My opinion is when part of the reason why I stopped teaching is most students were anemic by the time I got to them. Like, they needed an injection of so much nutrition and iron, and I was like, and it's really, I don't even know if it's their fault. Or like, you know, it's like, I felt like, you know, like that's why, like, in a way, like, I wanted to sort of like bring things in, like, by, like, I like rather do podcasts and like talk. Like, I'm doing a podcast now where I've gotten like all these artists to talk about the Red Studio and then their own process and share that with the world as a way of teaching. You know what I mean? So that like at least there's information out there so that I'm like helping people get their like vitamins as opposed to like sitting in a classroom trying to get people to sort of up off the ground. But it's like you guys have to do all the work yourself. School is not going to do it for you. Like the energy, my mom will say, she used to say like, she works so hard. And I would say that's not really what makes it happen. It's like, you also have to have some other kind of.
You looking at me? I don't know, just.
Well, what do you?
Mostly perspiration, but yeah, I mean, you know, there's luck. Being there, as the Peter Sellers movie says, that's also important, but you gotta be ready. Should we take another question?
Yes,
please.
Yeah, I just saw Pink Studio Rendezvous last week, so it's still up, but it was really amazing to see in person. One question.
Did you do a selfie?
No.
Before
I even knew you'd be here, and I just, yeah, it was amazing to hear it right after I saw that you'd be speaking here, but what would you tell your younger self as an artist?
That's such a good question. As an artist or as a human being?
Both. One of each.
God, it's so funny because I was just telling myself about something like that the other day. I would tell myself not to take shit like people so seriously when they like cut me. Like I would just tell them, I would like, you know, like let shit roll off my back. I used to always be like, you know, I was always like up for, you know, I took a lot of things serious. Like I took stuff like very high, you know, I took everything on like at a very high level. Like I didn't like, I wasn't sort of like that. I was like kind of intense. But there's nothing I could do. Like in a weird way, you know, it is what it is. You are who you are. And you muddle through and you find, you know, it's like, it's all, you're doing your life. You know, it's like, how do you make it easier on yourself? Is that always, is that even a thing? You know, it's just like, you know, maybe it shouldn't have been easier, you know? These paintings, you know, that, you know, the bad babies were made by a certain kind of person. They wouldn't have existed if I hadn't been that way. You know, if I hadn't been like so feisty.
Another question, please. Yes, please.
What do you think that having freedom is for an artist? Is it being able to do just whatever you want?
Well, define what you mean by whatever you want.
Whatever you feel like you need to make the most, I guess.
Because, like, there's whatever you want, and then in your studio, you never really make, there's no such thing. Yes, I think you should be able to do whatever you want as an artist, for sure. I really don't believe in, you know, censorship at all. But if you're going to make some fucked up shit that's gonna offend people, you better get ready to take a punch. And most people are not ready for that. And you better get ready to be alone and maybe not shown. A lot of people are like, I want to do this, that, and the other thing. And then they're like, where'd everybody go? Like, they want to do whatever they want to do, and then they want to be celebrated for it. And then it doesn't always work out like that. Yeah, you have the freedom to do whatever you want, but you have to take the other side, which is there's the results of that. So the other part of your question is, can you do whatever you want? I think that in your studio, there's a micro part of the question. At any given time, you're not doing whatever you want. You have to focus in your studio. There's, you know, like project-based things. Every given painting is solving a given problem. So it's not, I think, like most of the time, also in studios of younger artists, I think there's probably 10 paintings in a painting, and that's a problem. I'm going to say, here's my diagnosis. Most of you are probably doing too many paintings or too many sculptures in the same sculpture. Spread it out, like kind of look at your work and maybe pull one of the ideas out and risk making a small, like one idea instead of jamming them all in the same artwork. We get overly excited and stick it all in the same artwork. And that tends to muddy the waters. And like, if you think about like something like what's celebrated, let's say at like, like a Jackson Pollock painting, right? It's like, it's a pretty straightforward idea. He was focusing on like accomplishing something pretty simple. Don't be afraid to go for something very straightforward and simple, and be extremely advanced in the elements of what you're doing. Now, I believe it's 8:00, and we have to wrap up and go do some party and punching.
I think we do. Shall we just try one more? I mean, I like this like, no loaded nacho cheese paintings or, like, sculptures. Yes, please.
Yeah, don't do nachos.
Yeah.
The young man with the checkerboard.
Yeah, there you go. You
got to stand up, though, because it's hard to hear people in the back.
I just want to know, right now I'm really into color as well, saturation, and my favorite color at the moment is yellow. So I just want to know, what's your favorite color at the moment?
My favorite color at the moment?
And why?
Why is yellow your favorite color at the moment?
I like the mood, like it's like an emoji, like the smile. So I like how happy.
What's your name?
LaVon.
LaVon, stand up again. I can't see it. Listen, there's no such thing as yellow. Let me just give you a color lesson here, baby. What yellow? It's funny, I was swimming yesterday, as I just said earlier. I'm bragging, basically. And I was looking at your sky here in Tampa, and I was like, I'm going this way. And I'm like, what would you call that? That, oh, is that aqua? And then I looked a little bit over there, and I went, what's that, what would I call that, bullet blue? Then I turned my head this way, and I was like, what's that? And then I went back this way. Oh, the aqua changed to something else. Now it's, and it kept changing and changing and changing. And I'm like doing these laps. That pool was long. Then this girl got in with a bikini with her boyfriend, and they distracted me a little bit. And then like there was this other thing going on. It was like contrasting it. And I was thinking, God. How many, if I had the name, I want to get a pad out, but I can't because I'm swimming, and write down a name for every one of these blues, but the temptation would be to only name the bright blues. What if I also named the ones that aren't bright? See, this is my idea of a party. This is what I think about when I'm swimming. So this is what I would like you to do. Is start to name more specifically yellow for yourself. Don't stop at yellow. You need to make it a more, you know, it's just like saying you're a guy. I asked you your name, and then, you know, you're not just anybody. You're very specific. So like, don't treat yellow like it's just like a friggin' emoji, because it's not.
All right, listen, just two things before we go. One, actually the first one, obviously, go see the effing show, will you please?
Well, who if
you
did haven't, not see the effing show? Well, what's the matter with you?
Exactly, I don't know. I mean, I'm just guessing that maybe some of you haven't. And when you do, or when you walk out of here, after you have your coffee and your sweet, grab one of these, they're free, right? And they're actually quite
right
beautiful.
Here, so come
there
on
you go. And lastly, thank you, Lisa Yuskavage. Brilliant as always. Thank you.